Welcome to all of you here in the United States, in Japan, and from elsewhere around the world. I am Jerry Powers, Director of Catholic Peacebuilding Studies at the University of Notre Dame's Kroc Institute for International Studies and Keough School of Global Affairs. I also coordinate the Catholic Peacebuilding Network. This webinar is one of a series of events, publications, and other initiatives of the Catholic Peacebuilding Network's project on revitalizing Catholic engagement on nuclear disarmament. Because this project engages many institutions, we have many co-sponsors for this event. Notre Dame's Kroc Institute, the host for this event, is joined by Georgetown University's Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs, the Catholic University of America's Institute for Policy Research and Catholic Studies, Northwestern University's Scheel Catholic Center, Notre Dame's International Security Center, Notre Dame Center for Social Concerns and Minor in Catholic Social Tradition, and the International Federation of Catholic Universities. The question for today's discussion, are nuclear weapons an absolute evil? This is the provocative question posed to us by our special guest and main speaker 75 years after the second atomic bomb ever used in warfare destroyed his hometown, Nagasaki. The Most Reverend Joseph Mitsuaki Takami is Archbishop of Nagasaki and President of the Catholic Bishops Conference of Japan. He was born 7 months after the bombing, which killed his grandmother, two aunts, and an uncle, and left what Pope Francis called a black hole of destruction and death. Archbishop Takami has devoted his life to making sure that we never forget the dreadful events of August 6th and August 9th, 1945, and that never again is not just an empty slogan, but compels us to work tirelessly to control, reduce, and ultimately eliminate nuclear weapons. This is the second of three events with us in which Archbishop Takami has generously agreed to participate. This past August, he and the Japanese Catholic Bishops Conference joined Bishop David Malloy and the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops for a joint commemoration of the atomic bombings. That webcast can be found on YouTube. Tomorrow night, he will continue this conversation at 8 p.m. Eastern Time USA, 9 a.m. in the morning in Japan, with a smaller group of students. Tonight, Archbishop Takami will offer his personal reflections on the atomic bombings and his perspective on the moral and policy challenges of pursuing a world free of nuclear weapons. Thank you, Archbishop, for being with us today.
Good evening, here in Japan in the morning. Warmest greetings from Nagasaki, Japan. First of all, I would like to thank everyone who has worked hard on the preparation of this event. I especially thank the organizers of the event for their kind invitation. It is a great honor and joy for me to share with you my thoughts on the problem of nuclear weapons, one of the crucial problems in our world today. I hope my lecture will stimulate reflections on how our generation may be able to solve the problem of nuclear weapons. So I start now my lecture in Japanese. I'm sorry. 過去3,500年余りの 人類の歴史の中で戦争の記録のないのは 200年余りしかなく、 18世紀以降武力戦争、武力紛争のない年は 1年もありませんでした。第二次世界大戦だけで民間人と軍人の死者は 戦争に起因する飢餓や疫病による死者も含めて 6,000万から8,000万人と推定されています。戦後だけでも 100 を超える武力紛争が起こり、 その犠牲者は2100万にも及んでいると言われます。 人間には生きていくために所有欲が与えられています。しかし人々はしばしばその欲望を乱用し、権力と富を得るに従って他人のものを所有し、支配してきました。富裕国は武器を開発し、武力を増強していきました。そして意図的に他の人々の財産を奪い、そのために人命を奪うことを厭わない。その上で物質的な豊かさと安心を得ようとする、します。これが戦争というおぞましい行為であります。近世においては15世紀以降、ポルトガルとスペインが世界制覇を目論み、17世紀以降はイギリス帝国がそれを成し遂げ、オランダ、フランス、ドイツなども続いてアジアやアフリカや中東に勢力を伸ばしました。その中でカルヴァンの改革をモデルに徹底してイギリス国教会を改革しようとしたピューリタンは、新大陸に楽園を建設することが神から与えられた使命であると考え、しばしば先住民を殺戮しながら西へと移動しました。独立戦争当初、民兵組織が作られ、いわば一般市民が武器を手にして合衆国を建てました。こうして暴力によって紛争を解決する伝統が作られ、継承されたのではないかと思います。以後、アメリカはメキシコ、キューバ、プエルトリコ、フィリピン、ハワイ、アラスカなど、他社の土地や資源を手に入れながら、その行為は断じて私利私欲のためではないとされ、自由、進歩、文明化の推進という崇高な動機によるものとの美名を常にまとってきました。その姿勢は今日まで続いていると思います。その背景には、共産権の拡大増強を阻止するため、軍事包囲網を築くという意図がありました。その結果、軍産複合体が形成されてきました。今やアメリカは世界中に軍事基地を所有し、世界最大の核保有国であり、ロシアや中国とともに宇宙の軍事支配を目論んでいます。人類は18世紀までは基本的に1対1で相手を殺傷する方法で戦争を しましたが、ナポレオンが戦争で大量の大砲を配備し、アメリカ南北戦争で機関銃が使用されるようになってから、一回の軍事的行動で多数の人命を奪う戦争へと進展していきました。その極めつけが原子爆弾、水素爆弾という核兵器であると思います。核兵器は種々の点から見て重大な問題をはらんでいます。まず、天然資源の誤った利用です。天然資源は本来人間の全人的発展のために生かされるはずのものです。そのような天然資源を使って人間の命を奪い、傷つけるのが核兵器です。また、核兵器の開発と製造のために膨大な費用をかけ、それによって国の経済を潤わせ、維持することが許されるのでしょうか。むしろ、財は地球環境の回復や再生可能なエネルギーの開発などの分野に仕事を創生するために使うべきではないでしょうか。実際人間は地球と宇宙の環境を汚染し破壊し続けています。一刻も早く修復し回復する必要があります。カトリック教会のカテキズムは第二バチカン公会議の教えに基づいて次のように教えています。新しい兵器製造に用いられる巨万の富の消費は貧しい国の人々を救済する妨げとなり、諸民族の発展を阻害します。過剰軍備は、紛争の理由を増やし、対抗軍備の増強に拍車をかけかねません。教皇フランシスコも長崎でこう述べました。今日の世界では、何百万という子供や家族が人間以下の生活を強いられているにもかかわらず、武器の製造、改造、改良、維持、商いに財が費やされ、気づかれ、日ごと武器は一層破壊的になっています。これらは天に対する絶え間ないテロ行為です。以上の意味でも核兵器は、絶対悪と言えると思います。次に、この大量破壊だけを目的とした核兵器のいわば実証、実際に起こったことです。第一に、 原爆投下の前に日本は徹底的に空爆を受けました。1944年までにアメリカは日本軍に占領されていた地域を次々に奪還し、本土攻撃の体制を整えつつありました。実際空爆は同年6月から1944年6月から原爆投下まで断続的に行われました。最大規模の空襲は1945年3月10日の東京大空襲でした。被災者は約310万人、死者は11万5000人以上、負傷者は約15万人以上、損害家屋は約80万戸でした。このようにアメリカ軍は原爆を投下する前に日本の47都道府県の軍需工場のみならず、交通も市街地、小さな村や漁村に至るまで空爆し、徹底して破壊し、合わせて29万9485名の人々の命を奪っていました。米軍が上陸するときに少しでも犠牲を少なくするためという名目だったと聞いています。原子爆弾、1945年4月25日、ヘンリー・スティムソン陸軍長官とマンハッタン計画の監督、レスリー・グローブス准将はトルーマン大統領に原爆について詳細な説明をし、4ヶ月以内には一つの町全体を破壊できるような人類史上最強の破壊力を持つ爆弾が完成する予定であると伝えました。6月、155名の科学者が大統領に原爆の危険性を訴えるリオ・シラードの嘆願書に署名しましたが、グローブス准将はそれがスティムソンとトルーマンの目に触れないよう手を回しました。そして独自に科学者の意識調査を行いました。ところが 83% の、人が原爆を日本で使用する前に死実験すべきだと答えたのでした。それに失望し、その結果を結局無視しました。8月2日、ジェームズ・バーンズの補佐は日記に、オーガスタ環状にて大統領リービ・バーンズは日本が和平の道を探っているとの認識で一致しましたと書いています。しかしトルーマンも和平を望みましたが、彼はその前に原爆を使用したかったのです。ダグラス・マッカーサー元帥は原爆の使用を軍事的には全く不要と考えており、アメリカが間もなく使用する予定と知ると大変怒り失望したと言われます。で、実際に原爆がこうして使用されました。1945年8月6日午前8時15分広島にウラン原子爆弾が投下されました。その爆発力は TNT 火薬に換算すると 1.5 万トン相当とされています。8月6日原爆投下当時、広島には居住者、軍人、通勤や建物疎開作業への動員などによって周辺町村から入手した人を含めて約35万人の人がいたと考えられています。エノラ・ゲイの操縦士ポール・ティベッツは、町はこの恐るべき煙と炎の下に消滅してしまっていたと語ったといいます。原爆を4ヶ月の間、4ヶ月間の広島の死者は約14万人と推定されています。しかしアメリカの公式発表では日本兵3242人が死んだとだけなっていました。今年の原爆記念日までの広島の原爆死没者は延べ32万4129名です。広島への原爆投下の知らせを聞いたトルーマンは、これは史上最大の出来事だと飛び上がって叫び、しばらくしてこれは最も心躍る仕事だったと語ったといいます。一方、ソ連はすでに瀕死の状態にある日本を叩きのめすのに原爆は必要ではないと承知していたので、アメリカの狙いはソ連がアジアの覇者になることを阻み、ソ連がアメリカの国益を脅かすようなことがあれば原爆を使用することも辞さないという意思の表れだと推測し、不安を煽られました。日本が仲裁を期待したソ連は8月9日早朝、 満州、朝鮮、サハリン、千島列島の日本軍を撃破しました。この侵攻に日本が対応する前に、8月9日、まあ、午前11時2分、もう一発の原子爆弾が長崎に投下されました。爆発力は TNT2 万トン相当でした。当時の長崎市の人口はおよそ21万、まあ、実際にはもっといたんですが、まあ、21万だったとされています。長崎の 原爆による死者は4ヶ月後までに7万4千人でした。今年の原爆記念日までに延べ18万5982人です。死者。ユルンベルク裁判の首席検事テイラーは長崎への原爆投下は戦争犯罪であるとみなしていました。第二バチカン公会議が述べたように、都市全体または広い地域をその住民とともに無差別に破壊するための戦争行為はすべて神と人間自身に対する犯罪であり、ためらうことなく断固として断罪されなければならない。原子爆弾の、残虐さと人種差別、広島と長崎で原子爆弾が、残酷な大量破壊兵器であることが実証されました。一瞬にして何万という人の命、動植物、自然界、家財産、学校、病院、商店街、工場、文化財を破壊し、日常生活を奪った恐ろしい兵器です。2発の原子爆弾がこれまでに51万111名の命を奪ったことになります。そして生存、被爆者はまだ十数万おります。原爆は延べ50万人以上の人の命を奪っただけではなく、多くの被爆者を生涯にわたって肉体的、精神的に苦しめてきました。彼らは生きる喜びも意味も失うほど苦しい思いをしました。体に残った火傷の跡のためだけではなく、放射能が伝染すると信じられていたため、出会う人々から怖がられたり、避けられたり、差別されたりしました。多くの女性は結婚も断られました。一方、アメリカ軍は広島にウラン爆弾、長崎にはその 1.5 倍も威力のあるプルトニウム爆弾を使いました。2種類の爆弾を使い、原爆投下の1ヶ月後には医者や科学者に詳しい調査をさせ、翌年1月には軍の映像制作者や写真家に画像を撮らせています。つまり、原子爆弾の威力を試し、その結果のデータをさらなる兵器の改良のために集めたということです。もし原爆が実験のためであったとすれば、人間の尊厳を著しく侵す行為だったと言わなければなりません。その背景の一つに、日本人に対する憎しみと人種差別があったようです。日本人は猿同様に見られていたし、憎悪は日本軍による真珠湾奇襲攻撃、中国やフィリピンなどの戦場での野蛮な残虐な行為に起因していました。その一方、しかし、原爆投下に向かう戦闘機乗員は、例えば、司祭から祝福を受けています。アメリカでは、核兵器に関する恐ろしい事実は、依然、一般市民には明らかにされていませんでしたが、軍や政府の高官たちは原爆の使用を正当化し、核兵器開発に対してより多くの国民からの支持を得ようと、強力なメディア戦略を新たに実施しました。この戦略は、原爆によって多くのアメリカ人の命が救われ、戦争を終わらせるために原爆は軍事上絶対に必要不可欠だったという明確な主張を繰り返しとともに、大量被爆がもたらす被爆者への影響を改めて公式に否定するメッセージを発信し続けることでした。アメリカ政府幹部は自国メディアによる長崎や広島についての情報収集や報道を制限しました。それによってアメリカ国民の間に 原爆の必要性と倫理性に対する疑問の声が上がることを未然に防ぎ、急速に推し進められようとしていた自国の核兵器計画への反対意見を和らげようとしました。元陸軍長官スティムソンはハーパーズ氏1947年2月号に論文を寄稿し、原爆投下の正当性を主張しました。彼は、読者の道徳的関心がアメリカの担うべき義務へと向かうように論文を締めくくりました。その義務とは、核関連技術、核兵器開発、核実験に対する国際的な統制をアメリカが維持し、他国による核兵器の製造や使用を阻止することであると述べました。彼は、アメリカの主張にある核兵器によって、アメリカと世界の安全を維持されると強調しました。彼は、道徳上正しかったという確信に支えられた、他に類を見ない原爆使用の評価を確立したのです。その評価によって、他に何の説明や弁明も必要なくなり、それはアメリカ人の認識や記憶の中に真実として深く植え付けられました。その評価とは、原爆投下が戦争を終わらせ、100万人ものアメリカ人の命を救ったというものでした。しかも、アメリカの原爆投下は戦争犯罪とは見なされておりません。ローマ教皇庁は原爆投下を糾弾しました。全米教会協議会会長のジョン・フォスター・ダレス氏はこう述べています。仮に、敬虔なキリスト教国家である我が国が、このような核エネルギーを使用が人倫に基っていないと考えるのであれば、他の国の人々も同じような考えに走るだろう。核兵器は通常兵器の一種とみなされるようになり、人類が突如として永久に破滅する道が開かれるに違いない。実際、現在の国際情勢がそうなっています。もちろん日本も敗戦国として、それ相当の罰を受けたとはいえ、真珠湾を奇襲攻撃して戦争を引き起こし、最終的に千万単位のアジアの人々の命を失わせたことに対する責任をこれからも果たしていかなければなりません。核兵器実験と核処理の問題があります。人類が保持するべきではない核兵器の実験が1945年以来、今日までアメリカ、ソ連、現在のロシア、イギリス、フランス、中国、インド、パキスタン、北朝鮮などで繰り返されてきました。実際に関わった人々や実験場周辺の人々は当然被爆しています。マーシャル諸島での実験が示している通り、核兵器は人間の命だけでなく、自然環境にも深刻な影響を与えました。さらに現在の科学の力では、核兵器の処理を完全に行うことはできません。日本の福島第一原発の事故がそれを証明しています。人類は命を脅かす負の遺産を半永久的に後世に渡すべきではありません。核抑止論。2つの世界大戦を経験し、広島と長崎への原爆投下を知っていた教皇ヨハネ23世は、すでに60年近く前に、その最後の会食、地上の平和の中で次のように述べています。正義と英知と人間の尊厳を尊重するためには、軍備が同時に縮小され、核兵器が禁止され、最終的には軍備全廃達成が切実に要求されます。そして人々の心の中から戦争勃発の予感に対する恐れと不安を払拭するために、すべての人は心から協力し、努力しなければなりません。特に、軍備の均衡が、抑止力が、平和の条件であるという理解を、真の平和は相互の信頼の上にしか構築できないという原則に置き換える必要があります。 これは到達可能な目標でありますと教皇は主張しています。この教えは第二バチカン公会議の公文書とカトリック教会のカテキズムに組み込まれました。軍備拡張は起こりうる敵の攻撃を抑止し、諸国間にある種の平和を維持することのできる最も効果的な手段であると一般に考えられています。しかし武器の蓄積による抑止方法に対しては大いに倫理的疑問の余地が残されています。軍備拡張競争は平和を保障するものではありません。戦争の原因を除去するどころか、かえって増大させる危険をはらんでいます。教皇フランシスコも長崎で次のように訴えました。人の心にある最も深い望みの一つは平和と安定への望みです。核兵器や大量破壊兵器の保存はこの望みに対する最良の答えではありません。国際的な平和と安定は相互破壊への不安や壊滅の脅威を土台としたどんな企てとも相入れないものです。核兵器廃絶に向けた努力。核兵器に関しては様々な条約や廃絶に向けた様々な運動があります。中でも特に発行して締約国が増えれば最も効果的な条約は核兵器禁止条約であります。これは2017年7月7日、国連総会で122カ国および地域の賛成多数により採択されました。全核保有国、アメリカ、ロシア、イギリス、フランス、中国は不参加。NATO 加盟国やアメリカの核の傘下にある、核の傘の下にある日本、オーストラリア、韓国なども不参加でした。この条約は、開発、実験、製造、備蓄、異常、使用、威嚇としての使用のすべてを禁止するものです。この条約は50カ国が批准して90日後に発効します。2017年9月20日に調印批准の受付が始まりました。同じ日にこの条約に批准した国はガイアナ、タイ王国、バチカン市国でした。2020年8月現在、この核兵器禁止条約を批准した国は44カ国になりましたが、最近5カ国に減ったといいます。さらに、グティエレス、事務総長だったと思いますが、おそらく今月かあるいは今年中には、50カ国になるだろうという見通しを述べました。この地球上から核兵器を廃絶するための最も有効なこの手段を生かすために、すべての人の協力が必要です。教皇フランシスコは、やはり長崎でこう強調しました。無数の人々が望んでいる核兵器から解放された平和な世界を実現するためには、個々人、宗教団体、市民社会、核兵器保有国も非保有国も、軍隊も民間も国際機関も、すべての人の参加が必要です。結論といたします。上記の理由で核兵器は絶対悪と言わなければなりません。その理由は繰り返しと次のようなものです。まず、全人的発展のために活用すべき自然の資源を逆に人の命を奪うために利用することは悪です。核兵器の開発、製造、維持、管理のために膨大な経費をかけているけれども、飢えや病気で、疫病で命を失う無数の人々や、悪化する一方の地球環境はなおざらにされています。これは倫理的に間違っています。広島と長崎に投下された原子爆弾は、今年8月までに合わせて50万人以上の人の命を奪っています。より深刻なのは、被爆が 人体に与えた影響です。1キロメートル以内の被爆者は数千度の熱や外傷だけでなく放射能の強い障害を受けて 95% が死亡しました。2キロ以内の被爆者には皮膚がケロイド状になり、3ヶ月から10年の間原爆白内障にかかり、染色体の異常、小凍症の人もいました。さらに時間が経過すると白血病、これは白血病が異常に増殖するものです。あるいはがん、甲状腺、この、乳がんとか胃がん、その他、がんにかかる人が出てきました。私の母も、兄も、いとこたちも、まだがんで亡くなりました。強い被爆者には肉体だけ、強い被爆を受けた人には肉体だけでなく、差別や偏見などの精神的な苦しみも受けました。2発の爆弾がもたらしたものは、地上のこの地獄でした。正常な人間が作り出せるものではないと思います。原爆は絶対悪としか言えません。最近、被爆者たちが集まって、話し合って、悪魔の爆弾だと言っています。原爆の使用は正当化できないと思います。まだ実際殺されてもいない、例えば100万人としても、実際にまだ殺されていない人々の命を救うためという理由で、何十万もの人の命を奪い、何の咎めも受けないということが、神と人の前で許されることでしょうか。しかも背景には人種差別や憎悪があったとすれば、キリスト教的な観点から容認されえないことだと思います。核兵器の実験も、実際の使用と同じような深刻な影響を生命に与えています。核兵器の完全な処理もできず、核のゴミを蓄積することは、すべての命を軽視し脅かす行為です。この無責任さを引き起こす核兵器は絶対悪と言わなければなりません。原子力の戦争目的の使用は人類とその尊厳に反するだけでなく、私たちの共通の家である地球の未来におけるあらゆる可能性に反する犯罪です。倫理に反します。これは教皇フランシスコがおっしゃったことです。核兵器の保有、それ自体が倫理に反する。倫理に反するとは、神と人間に対してなすべき本来の正しい良いことに反します。つまり、根本的に悪いという意味です。核兵器の唯一の目的は、人を殺し、すべてを破壊することにあります。その意味で、核兵器そのものが悪です。それゆえ、核兵器を使用することはもちろん、所有すること自体も倫理に反する、つまり悪であると言わなければなりません。理由がどうであれ、戦争は人間を殺戮する行為です。正当化できません。人の命を抹消する行為は悪以外の何者でもありません。その悪を効果的に実行可能にするのは核兵器であります。そしてそれが存在する限り、欲しがる国が増え、使用される危険が常にあります。核兵器は国を守るために必要だから良いものだと考えるべきではないと思います。必要悪と。それは人類の安全を脅かすためだけだからです。人類の安全を脅かすだけだからです。悪いものであれば当然なくさなければなりません。核兵器は絶対悪ですが、それを製造し使用するのは人間です。人間が神を自分の根源及び究極の目的として認めることを拒み、自分と他者及び全被造物との間の調和を破ることにところに問題があります。しかしそれを完全に廃棄廃絶することができるのもまた人間しかいません。特にキリストの死によって神の愛を知っているキリスト者は他の人々を愛し生かすことしか望まないはずです。ところで核廃絶の最も現実的で効果的な手段が核兵器禁止条約の批准とそれを守る、遵守することです。最後に、広島と長崎への原爆投下は正しかったと確信している人々には、原爆投下によって何十万もの 無実の市民の尊い命が奪われ、生涯苦しみ続けている人々が大勢いるという現実を直視し、認めていただきたいと思います。そして、その償いとして絶対悪である核兵器を廃絶し、先頭に立って諸国間の信頼関係を築いていただきたいと思います。Thank you very much for your attention. すみません、長くなりました。
Thank you, Archbishop, for sharing your detailed perspective on the legacy of the atomic bombings and for your equally detailed explanation of why you believe nuclear weapons should be considered an absolute evil.、Mm. We are fortunate to have with us three specialists who will comment briefly on Archbishop Takami's remarks in the context of evolving Catholic perspectives on nuclear deterrence, nuclear proliferation, and nuclear disarmament.I will introduce them more briefly than is warranted in the order in which they will speak. Hirokazu Miyasaki is K. Davis Professor of Anthropology at Northwestern University. He has authored or co-edited 4 books on the anthropology of hope and has a forthcoming book on the history of citizen diplomacy between Japan and the United States, for the purpose of a world without nuclear weapons. In 2018,The mayor of Nagasaki appointed him as a peace correspondent for the city. Father Drew Christensen is Distinguished Professor of Ethics and Human Development in Georgetown School of Foreign Service and a senior fellow at the Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs. He was a frequent consultant to the Holy See on issues of nuclear disarmament and was a member of the Holy See delegation during the 2017 negotiations on the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons.He is co-editor of a new book called A World Free from Nuclear Weapons, which is a compilation of talks given at the 2017 Vatican Conference on Disarmament. And finally, Dr. Marianne Kusumano Love is Associate Professor of International Relations and a fellow at the Institute for Policy Research and Catholic Studies at the Catholic University of America. She is a member of the U.S. Catholic Bishops International Justice and Peace Committee,and served with Father Christensen on the Holy See's delegation during the 2017 nuclear ban treaty negotiations. Why don't we begin with you, Dr. Miyazaki.
All right, thank you, Jerry, for that kind introduction. And thank you, Archbishop Takami, for that inspiring lecture. And I also like to thank the organizers of this event for their hard work they put into this really significant event.Hiroshima rages, Nagasaki prays. This frequently invoked contrast speaks to the relative silence of Nagasaki atomic bomb survivors. The contrast also implies the central place Catholicism occupies in the global memory of the bombing of Nagasaki. The atomic bomb was detonated over the district of Urakami in the northern suburbs of Nagasaki, where the Catholic population hadhistorically concentrated in Nagasaki. Over 8,000 of approximately 12,000 parishioners of Urakami perished in the bombing. The bombing of Nagasaki, once a Jesuit territory and a city that is widely remembered for the martyrdom of missionaries and the persistence of local Catholics' faith during centuries of persecution, sent shockwaves throughout Catholic communities worldwide. Although the damage caused by the atomic bombing extended far beyond Urakami and the Catholic community in Nagasaki, the Catholic voice quickly became dominant in the representation of the atomic bombing of Nagasaki. In particular, Dr. Nagai Takashi, a Catholic radiologist and a Urakami parishioner,became an internationally influential spokesperson for Nagasaki. Dr. Nagai's 1949 book, The Bells of Nagasaki, whose publication was curiously permitted by the Allied Occupation Administration as an exception to its strict censorship, set the tone of the commemoration of the bombing of Nagasaki in subsequent years. Dr. Nagai's controversial thesis,that the atomic bombing was divine providence in which Urakami parishioners were chosen as sacrificial lambs for world peace, has often been cited as one of the main causes of the relative silence of Catholic atomic bomb survivors in Nagasaki. The Catholic Church in Nagasaki was long publicly silent on the bombings and nuclear disarmament beyond the annual commemorative activities in August. Bishop, later Archbishop Paul Aijiro Yamaguchi, was not in Japan at the time of the bombing, as he had been sent to Flores, Indonesia for pastoral and religious propaganda work. Bishop Yamaguchi, originally from Murakami, lost his mother and several other relatives in the bombing, and yet he made few public remarks about the bombing after his return to Nagasaki. While traveling through North America on his way back from Rome from late 1950 until early 1951, Bishop Yamaguchi said in Calgary, Canada, the Japanese people want no more atomic bombs anywhere. That is our desire. It was very bad, so terrible. This rare public remark on the bombing was made in the specific context of the threat of the use of nuclear weapons in the Korean War. On his second trip to the US to raise funds for the reconstruction of Murakami Cathedral, the bishop repeatedly emphasized that Catholics in Nagasaki were not angry about the bombing. In the two critical decades following the devastation of his diocese, Bishop Yamaguchi focused his energy on its reconstruction rather than engaging in anti-nuclear activism. It was in the 1980s that the Catholic Church in Nagasaki began to be more actively involved in anti-nuclear activism. Archbishop Yamaguchi's successor, Cardinal Satowaki, originally from the historically significant Catholic coastal village of Shizu, outside the city of Nagasaki, was the Archbishop of Nagasaki from 1968 until 1990. The Cardinal played a key role in Pope John Paul II's visit to Hiroshima and Nagasaki in February 1981. The Pope's visit served as impetus for the energization of anti-nuclear activism, both inside and outside the church in Nagasaki. In particular, Pope John Paul's appeal for peace began with a declaration in Japanese, "War is the work of man." This declaration was received by many in Nagasaki, particularly in the Catholic Church, as a direct refutation of Dr. Nagai's divine providence thesis, and many Nagasaki Catholics felt encouraged by this to be more actively engaged in anti-nuclear activism. The effects of this energization include Catholic doctor and anti-nuclear movement leader Dr. Akizuki's inclusive vision of peace activism during the 1980s, and the Catholic mayor of Nagasaki, Motoshima's robust campaign for the elimination of nuclear weapons, anchored in his effort for reconciliation in East Asia during the 1980s and the early 1990s. It was Archbishop Takami, however, who elevated the Catholic Church's commemoration of the atomic bombings and its commitment to nuclear disarmament to the next level. Archbishop Takami is an atomic bomb survivor himself. He was a three-month-old fetus at the time of the bombing, and the first and most likely the last Archbishop of Nagasaki who survived the atomic bombing. For the last decade or so, the Archbishop has actively promoted a Catholic vision of a world without nuclear weapons internationally. For example, in 2010, at the time of the Non-Proliferation Treaty NPT Review Conference, Archbishop Takami declared at the UN's Tillman Chapel, "I dare say that the existence of nuclear weapons is intrinsically evil, and there is no reason whatsoever to justify this deadly weapon." Yet, it is important to keep in mind that Archbishop Takami's strong condemnation of the atomic bombings and nuclear weapons has always been anchored and placed within the framework of love and forgiveness. For example, last year, on August 9th, in his homily for the annual Peace Mass on Peace Mass at Wirken Cathedral, Archbishop Takami revisited Dr. Nagai's Divine Providence thesis. Archbishop Takami suggested that underlying Dr. Nagai's thesis was his commitment to the promise of reconciliation in Jesus' death. Importantly, he suggested in the homily that Dr. Nagai and other Urakami parishioners were angry, very angry at Americans for the bombing, but also that Dr. Nagai did not condemn the bombing precisely because he embraced Jesus' forgiveness of sins on the cross. At the end of the homily, the Archbishop mentioned the atrocities caused by Japan's wartime aggression toward other Asian nations and recalled Jesus' challenge. Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone. Archbishop's call for the elimination of the absolute evil of nuclear weapons is anchored in his faith in the possibility of radical conversion based on forgiveness and reconciliation. This conversion will set free our capacity to hope, which will in turn enable our collective engagement in a difficult and yet necessary effort to rebuild mutual trust from the ground up. In this sense, the Archbishop has folded rage and prayers together into a powerful challenge for all of us to intentionally and persistently pursue peace in the spirit of love.
Thank you very much for your remarks and for explaining in more detail the Catholic community's response over the past 75 years. We now turn to Father Christensen.
Thank you, Jerry. And thank you, Professor Hiro. Professor Miyazaki, I have to tell you all, is the living link that's made this work possible. He's done an enormous amount of work in bringing our own Catholic Peacebuilding Network initiative here to work with our Japanese colleagues. We're very grateful for that. Bishop Takami, I want to thank you for giving us so much to think about this evening, for challenging us in the United States to take responsibility for the atomic bombings of Japan, and for deploying nuclear weapons as a deterrent up to the present day, even ironically, for the defense of Japan. Because so many Americans still believe Henry Stimson's rationalization that the bomb had to be used to save lives in a quest for a quick end to the war, I take that test with particular seriousness. All people resist facing the truth about their history. It has taken 160 years for the United States to address the sin of slavery, and we are still not done. Japan has its problems reckoning with its past history as well. How long will it take to do a moral reckoning with the bomb, with the buildup of the military-industrial complex that lies behind the nuclear deterrent? I don't know, but we can begin to do so. The Second Vatican Council condemned World War II's two great evils, the genocide we know as the Holocaust and weapons of mass destruction. It branded the methodical extermination of an entire people, nation, or ethnic minority as criminal. It declared any act of war aimed indiscriminately at the destruction of entire cities or extensive areas along with their populations is a crime against God and humanity. It merits unequivocal and unhesitating condemnation. Our response, both Japanese and Americans, to this evil must be the response of Jews to the Holocaust. Never again. The atomic bomb, the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the nuclear arms race, and the nuclear weapons industry are dreadful evils. The Battle of Britain and the firebombings of Tokyo, Hamburg, and Dresden were likewise monstrous. They killed hundreds of thousands of people and destroyed vast areas as well. By those last months of World War II, both sides had already lost their moral compass. Yet machetes slaughtered more people in a few months in Rwanda than any of those aerial attacks. Stalin and Mao systematically killed tens of millions with conventional means, including starvation and prison camps. Mass killing, all its forms, was the besetting evil of the 20th century. Some of the perpetrators of the bombings illustrate what Hannah Arendt called the banality of evil. General Leslie Groves, for example, used the bombings as bureaucratic justification for the Manhattan Project. And General Curtis LeBay, in his obsession with saturation bombing, shows how a shallow measure of military efficiency can overwhelm moral sense and professional training. Likewise, Edward Teller, the real-life Dr. Strangelove, in his relentless quest for the super, the hydrogen bomb, showed how immune even brilliant scientists can be to the moral lessons of history. On the other hand, Robert Oppenheimer, in his opposition to the super, his later pursuit of disarmament, and his career-ending contestations with Louis Strauss at the Atomic Energy Commission and later the House Un-American Activities Committee, shows how lasting moral conversion is possible, even in the highest places. Similarly, the veterans of the Manhattan Project who founded the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists show how those who come face to face with evil that they have helped produce can become agents of good. Rhetorically, perhaps it helps us to convey the depth of our moral revulsion to call the whole phenomenon of nuclear warfare absolutely evil. But on reflection, I'm reluctant to use that term because the notion of absolute evil precludes any possibility of good in the human reality which gave rise to them. Doing so, it denies the human capacity to turn from evil to the good. As Aquinas argued, evil being in the will can never be total because human will will always retain its basic orientation to the good. Today, Pope Francis asks us to say no to the whole system of nuclear war fighting, even if for the purposes of deterrence. How do we say no? As the Archbishop has told us, the principal vehicle for opposition to nuclear weapons is the Treaty on Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. Adopted by the United Nations Conference in 2017, 84 countries have already signed the treaty and 46 have ratified it as of this date. It lacks formal ratifications to enter into force. The nuclear powers have ignored and resisted the treaty. But there is space for movement, even in states formally allied to NATO and so-called umbrella states like Japan and South Korea. I can comment on that later. Last month at the United Nations, Pope Francis declared it is important to support the principal international legal instruments on nuclear disarmament, disarmament, non-proliferation, and prohibition. That is our broad agenda, non-proliferation, disarmament, and prohibition. Like Pope St. Paul VI before him, Pope Francis sees the church as a community of movements and communities, charged with responsibility to read the signs of the times and to discern together the changes that are urgently needed in public policy. Here are some of those signs. One, today there are 9 nuclear powers, only 5 belong to the Non-Proliferation Treaty. 2, the nuclear armed state members of the Non-Proliferation Treaty have avoided their commitments under the treaty to pursue disarmament seriously. 3, rather than serving solely as a deterrent, today nuclear weapons stand at the heart of military strategies of the nuclear powers against non-nuclear threats. 4, New developments like cyber warfare and hypersonic missiles make defense against missile attacks virtually impossible. 5, the arms control architecture of the Cold War and the post-Cold War eras have collapsed. And 6, even prohibitions against militarization of outer space are eroding. In the company of men and women of conscience, Catholics need to share their conviction that now is the time for abolition. 60 years ago, Pope St. John XXIII taught that abolition is the ultimate goal of nuclear disarmament. It falls on this generation to make it a reality. Let us carry out the duty the Second Vatican Council set the whole church: scrutinize the signs of the times and interpret the nuclear threat in light of the gospel. Let us assume the responsibility that is ours to guide aright the forces of the atom which humanity has unleashed. Thank you all.
Thank you, Father Christensen. And finally, but absolutely not least, is Marianne Kusmanolov.
Thank you, Archbishop Takami, for your hospitality when I was in Nagasaki. But tonight, thank you for reminding us how the rest of the world views nuclear weapons as dangerous, unnecessary, and immoral. Most of the countries in the world do not have nuclear weapons. They've already banned them in their territories through a series of nuclear weapons-free zones and through the Nuclear Ban Treaty. Citizens also work to divest from nuclear weapons through campaigns like Don't Bank on the Bomb. Your remarks echo themes that Pope Francis raises in his new encyclical yesterday, Fratelli Tutti. We are not doomed to divisions or to perpetually continue the unjust structures of the past, including nuclear deterrence. COVID-19 exposes the status quo as immoral and unsustainable. We now have a chance and a choice to prepare the future in line with our values. Today, we spend over $1 trillion on new nuclear weapons during a global pandemic while millions die. We can change these policies. You and Pope Francis remind us that dialogue is not only possible, but required. To do this, we must, as you discuss, first debunk the myths that nuclear deterrence is ethical and the best we can hope for. Both propositions are wrong. Nuclear deterrence is immoral, whether you use a Kantian, a consequentialist, a just war, a Catholic social teaching, or a just peace moral lens. A lot has changed in our ethical thinking, in the realm of what's possible, and in the empirical reality concerning the weapons since 1983, when the US Catholic bishops conceded a temporary, strictly conditional, interim moral acceptance of nuclear deterrence. Since then, apologists who want to baptize the bomb have distorted that into a permanent embrace of the nuclear status quo, which it never was. The interim ethics of deterrence relied on several assumptions: that nuclear war fighting is never acceptable, is immoral, and that there would be a robust nuclear taboo; that nuclear weapons would only be used for deterrence; that nuclear disarmament and peace building were more moral, more desirable, but they deemed it to be impossible at that time; that no better relationship with nuclear foes was possible; therefore, threats of genocide and ecocide forever are the only possible relationships among adversaries; that the risks of possessing nuclear weapons is negligible and less than the risk of an invasion by the then communist Soviet Union, so an idea of better dead than red; that nuclear weapons can be or are being safeguarded, protected from use, from accident, from theft, from proliferation, and that the military and political institutions tasked with this safeguarding are up to the task; that policymakers have no conflict of interest, no financial interest in promoting or profiting from the nuclear weapons complex. None of these assumptions have been valid for at least the past decade. The nuclear taboo is eroding. President Trump threatens using nuclear weapons. The Nuclear Posture Review threatens using nuclear weapons, even in response to conventional and cyber attacks. New nuclear weapons are being developed to make them more usable. This explodes the assumption that nuclear weapons are possessed exclusively for deterrence purposes. Nuclear weapons are not keeping the peace. Instead, nuclear weapons have created wars. The U.S. military invaded Iraq because of nuclear weapons. These wars had devastating cascading effects, destabilizing the region, creating ISIS, and spilling over into a civil war in Syria and neighboring countries that Pope Francis calls a world war in piecemeal. Israel attacked Syria and Iraq over nuclear weapons. Nuclear weapons have not deterred conflict among nuclear-armed states. India, Pakistan, China, India have ongoing shooting wars. The nuclear weapons complex is unsafe. An octogenarian nun, Sister Megan Rice, demonstrated this as she broke in for prayer and protest at one of the supposedly super secure facilities. Many nuclear accidents have occurred. The nuclear weapons military bureaucracy is breaking down. There is a better way. A just peace approach to preparing the future is working, building peace around the world, and it's needed to build peace among nuclear states. We must apply just peace principles and practices, participation, restoration, right relationship, reconciliation, and stability, themes that Pope Francis talked about in his encyclical yesterday and the Archbishop discussed today. The people impacted by nuclear weapons have been excluded from decision-making about them. And nuclear deterrence proponents are mainly powerful white men from rich nuclear countries, some of whom profit from nuclear weapons. They have imposed the costs and dangers of nuclear arms on those most vulnerable. Eternal threats of genocide do not restore right relationships. They do not lead to a sustainable peace that protects the planet. Our dialogue tonight proves that peace is possible, even after a war that killed millions, even after the horrific use of atomic weapons. How can we proceed? As educators, we must educate, forming the next generation in just peace, reaching those who are not really engaged on these issues. Nearly half of the world population is under age 25. Tomorrow, we'll invite students to engage with the Archbishop as part of our outreach efforts. As citizens, we must not let COVID turn us inward, but we can use this opportunity to prepare the future, a world without nuclear weapons. We can advocate for cutting funding, press for the resumption of nuclear disarmament talks, and extend agreements such as New START, support the ban treaty and Don't Bank on the Bomb, and we can vote for and hold our leaders to reestablish the nuclear taboo rather than threatening to use nuclear weapons. As Pope Francis said yesterday, we must create a better politics based on dialogue, justice, and peace.
Thank you very much, Dr. Love. Okay, we are running a little bit behind time, so let's move quickly to some questions. We received many questions through pre-registration and during this conversation. Let me begin with you, Archbishop Takami. Dr. Love just said that we need restoration and reconciliation. Japan and the United States have been close allies for decades. 75 years after the atomic bombings and the end of World War II, is there still a need for reconciliation between our two countries? Or should our focus be on not on the past, but on what we can do today and in the future to reduce and eliminate nuclear weapons?
この質問に答えるんですね。
日米は今友好関係にありますが、まだ日米の和解の問題は今日存在すると思われますか？それから友好関係にありますので、協力関係にありますので、過去のことではなくて、現在、これからどうやって、協力していくかということに、焦点を当てた方が良いのではないでしょうか。
まず先ほどのお礼を言っていいですかね、今。
はい。
First of all, thank you so much, Father Christiansen.For your precious remarks on my lecture. I appreciate your opinion about the absoluteness of nuclear weapons. And Dr. Marianne Love, I thank you very much for your very rich comment. I learned a great deal from your comment, especially your discussion of the US CCB's interim ethics and the idea of just peace. Thank you very much. まず戦争を起こしたのは日本だとよく言われますが、まあ、それは事実だと思います。まあ、その背景はいろいろあって、それなりの理由があったと思いますが、もう一方でアメリカは、やはりこの原子爆弾を、まあ、開発し、実際に使ったという責任は免れないと思います。その原子爆弾を作って、使ったということから、今の核兵器の問題が広がって大きくなっていると私は思っています。ですから、アメリカはまず自分のその責任をどうやって今果たすかということを考えていただかないと、日本もいわばその被害者であったにもかかわらず、その同じ原子力の傘のもとにあって、動けない状態にあるんですね。で、それが世界に平和をもたらすというよりも、むしろ脅威を与えているんではないか。だからそのような現状打開をまずお互いに考えることから和解が始まるんではないかと思います。ちょっと長くなりました。
So, Archbishop saying that it was indeed Japan who started the war.But the fact remains, the U.S. Developed and used atomic bombs against Japan, and U.S. cannot really escape from that responsibility. And the fact that the U.S. hasn't really taken that responsibility has really led, and also the U.S. actually used atomic bombs at the end of the war has led to the situation we are finding ourselves in today, and that is we confront this really deadlock in the conversation about nuclear disarmament, and also Japan is a country that was attacked, bombed with nuclear weapons, the only country that was bombed with nuclear weapons.And yet, it has been put in a nuclear umbrella of the United States, and the Japanese government is not able to express its opposition to nuclear weapons in a straightforward manner. So the reconciliation needs to take place.And also the step towards the nuclear disarmament really needs to begin with reconciliation of these two countries' war responsibilities, and then we can, for the first time, can move together towards nuclear disarmament.
Thank you, Archbishop.
要するにもう一ついいですかね。悪の循環をいわばアメリカが、まあ、悪の循環を、核兵器に関しては悪の循環をいわばアメリカが作ったとすれば、やはりその責任を、悪の循環を断ち切らないといけないと思います。で、日本は、決してアメリカに対して怒ったり許さないとかということではないわけで、たくさんの経済的な恩恵も受けて、アメリカの寛大なその友情というか、で今の日本の発展があったわけで、それはアメリカの人たちに大変私たちは負っていると思います。おかげだと思っています。しかしその軍事的なことに関して言えば、やはり、世界的に脅威を与えて、いる責任というのはアメリカだけではありませんが、まず第一にその核兵器を作って使ったそのことで悪の循環を作ったという責任は、それを断ち切ることで果たさなければ、ならないのではないかと思います。私たち日本は平和を望んでアメリカと協力していきたいと思っています。まあ、すでに協力していますが。
So Japan has benefited from its friendly relationship, post-war friendly relationship with the United States, and owes a great deal to the U.S. for post-war economic development. And however, it is the U.S. who, in terms of when it comes to nuclear weapons and today's military situation globally, it is the U.S. who created a cycle of evil. And it is really the U.S.'s responsibility to break that cycle so that Japan and other countries can work together with the U.S. towards world peace.
Thank you. Let me turn to a question a number of people had, and this is a common response to those who say that nuclear weapons are immoral and we need to move toward nuclear disarmament. Maybe Dr. Love, I can address this to you. Are there any situations where, or any way that nuclear weapons, nuclear deterrence can be seen as a necessary evil in order to maintain at least a negative peace? And if nuclear weapons cannot be disinvented, then how can we talk about eliminating nuclear weapons?
No, I don't think nuclear weapons are needed for deterrence to have a negative peace, because they don't create peace. They're actually an obstacle to peace. They're keeping in place a frozen conflict and blocking the opportunity to move towards deeper disarmament. We have a great deal of experience in how wars end. They end with disarmament, demobilization, reintegration, reconciliation, and none of that can be done as long as you are armed to the teeth and threatening the annihilation of the other. So they're actually an obstacle to peace. But how to get there from here? I don't actually see abolition and step-by-step disarmament as opposed. You need both. You need to move step by step. You can't obviously remove them all tomorrow. But you need to be going step by step with the goal of getting to this very deep level of disarmament. And if you don't have that goal, then you're gonna get stuck along the path of disarmament, which is what we have witnessed in our history, that we've had a little bit of disarmament, then we stop. Little bit, then we stop. And any time that you're doing that without the acceptance or the commitment to the larger goal, you're keeping the door open for new nuclear arms races, as we're seeing now.
Father Christensen, on a related issue, this question focuses on the absolute evil designation, or I think the Pope talking about both the use and even the possession of nuclear weapons is immoral. Is that kind of sort of black and white approach to the morality of nuclear weapons polarizing in some ways that might negatively impact the arms control and disarmament process?
I think that the ban is not as Marianne said, something to be considered in opposition to step-by-step disarmament, but is intended to solidify the goal is global zero. And it seems to me that the two can go together, and there's a real need for reconciliation between the ban advocates on the side of humanitarian international law on the one hand, and the arms controllers and disarmament people on the other, who have a kind of their own kind of sub-ideological battle over this and reluctance to engage one another. It seems to me that the two go together, and we need to encourage that both at the level of experts and at the level of nations. I think that the Holy Father's language is intended to reframe the question. We thought for decades that the question had been settled by the parameters set down by the US bishops, and for which the lines have been set up by Pope John Paul II. But as a matter of fact, none of that was at least came not to be true in the real world of policy and arms development. The arms are not used exclusively for deterrence purposes. The numbers are still well above what's needed for sufficiency. And we've halted on disarmament. Now, there was progress for a decade, perhaps, in disarmament, and then we've halted. And we're going back by all sorts of arms control treaties being abandoned or canceled. And so it seems to me that we need to reinitiate the process that creates that, and that the Holy Father is setting the goal very clearly as eventual elimination, as John the 23rd did 60 years ago. But he's taken the game away from those who want to say, oh, you can just quibble about this and quibble about that. No, this is a big issue. You need to have big parameters, and the goal is elimination.
Thank you, Drew. Dr. Miyazaka, you're working on a book on U.S.-Japanese citizen diplomacy in support of nuclear disarmament. Could you say a little bit about what kind of citizen diplomacy you see as an effective way to move this conversation forward?
Thank you, Jerry. I think what Pope Francis has said really should serve as a model for the kind of peace we should strive to achieve. That is the kind of peace that is based on mutual trust, rather than the kind of peace enabled by nuclear weapons. And towards the goal of achieving that the kind of peace based on mutual trust, we need to be really patient in building that trustful relationships from the bottom up. And it is really the kind of exchanges of seemingly insignificant kind across the borders in all kinds of directions at all levels, and conversations and dialogues that really serve as kind of building blocks of that peace. So only achieving that peace will serve as alternative to deterrence. So I see in all kinds of efforts at the citizen level, grassroots level, kind of hope I really see as an alternative to nuclear weapons. This is not really a naive hope, but this is really a necessary step towards the building of an alternative framework for peace.
Archbishop, the last word for you is, Dr. Miyazaki just talked a bit about citizen diplomacy. What about bishops' diplomacy? What should the U.S. and Japanese bishops, or at least the Japanese bishops, what's the most important thing that you can be doing, that you are doing right now, or that you plan to do, that you'd like to share with everyone?
それで日米の司教団で平和のためのできることというのはどういうことでしょうかということを、最後の締めくくりとして、語っていただきたいと。
そうですね。まず教会の規模がまるで何と言ったらいいか、違いますよね。そういう何と言ったらいいか、社会背景とかいろいろな違いが大きい、人数だけじゃなくて歴史的な背景とかその考え方の違いというのは大きいように思いますが、このことについて正直私たちアメリカの司教たちとこうしっかり時間を取って話し合ったことがないんですね。今まで、この前カント司教様とその初めてでしたかね、長崎に来られた、ただ唯一のアメリカの司教だったと思います。長崎に来られましたね、数年前。それ、ぐらいでありまして、その時もゆっくりこの核兵器とか平和についての話はしてないので、私も、もし可能ならですね、アメリカの、司教様たちと、もう少しこう、この、もう1日でもかけてでも、2日かけてでも、何か、ゆっくり、平和とかこの軍備の問題について時間を取って話し合うということがまず必要かなと。お互い何を考えているかあまり理解していない、みんな平和を望んでいるんですけども、この平和の実現の仕方がどうも違うんではないかと思って、アメリカはどうしてもカトリックにしてもその兵器はまさに必要だという考えだと思うんですけども、私はその戦争はどうしても避けられないでしょう。人間は争うことがあるので戦争は避けられないけれども、 少なくとも核兵器は必要ではないと。核兵器を使うべきではない、持つべきではない。だから、まあ、とにかくアメリカの司教たちと本当にカトリックのキリストの平和というものをに基づいて、何が私たちが何をすべきかということについて話し合うことができたら、それが一番まずはスタートかなと思います。はい。
Thank you. So I'm aware of the all sorts of differences in between the church in Japan and a church in the U.S.Not only in terms of the size, you know, the Japanese churches are relatively small, and but also the historical context in which Catholicism was established in these two countries is quite different. But more importantly, the Archbishop has never had a seriousand sustained conversation about this issue with any U.S. bishops. And that should be something he would like to have. And it's at the 70th anniversary of the bombing, the chair of the International Peace, Justice and Peace Committee of USCCB visited Nagasaki.And there was an opportunity for the Archbishop to speak with him about peace, but the conversation was brief and somewhat kind of abstract. And he knows that we all Christians and Catholics hope for peace, but perhaps the approaches the church takes in US and Japan,perhaps approaches are quite different. And I'm aware of the connections the Catholic Church has with the US military. And I don't really naively believe that we can abolish war right away. And humans are prone to find themselves in conflict, big and small. And yet I am convinced thatit is absolutely not necessary for us to have nuclear weapons. So at least on that point, perhaps we can all agree. But in any case, it is his desire and hope to have a sustained dialogue over a day or two even between Japanese bishops and the US bishops on the issue of nuclear weapons in the near future.
Thank you, Archbishop. It's been clear to me, I've been working on this issue with the church since 1980. And while one main task we have always had is to bring morality into what is often a religion-free and morality-free zone of discussions on nuclear weapons, the Archbishop reminds us that we have a lot to do within the church itselfto engage in dialogue on this issue and to do, to do everything that we can do as a Catholic community on this issue. So thank you for that suggestion, Archbishop. And thank you very much, Archbishop, for spending so much time with us this evening and in advance for tomorrow evening. It's a privilege to have you with us. We really appreciate you spending the time.We also thank Dr. Miyazaki for both your translation and your comments on the church, the wider church's role on the nuclear question in Japan. And thank you, Dr. Christensen and Dr. Love. And also thank you to my colleagues here at the Kroc Institute, Annie Ortega-Shine and Lisa Gallagher, who connected us all this evening and made this event possible. Finally, two quick program notes.Again, the Archbishop has kindly agreed to join us again tomorrow, 1/2 hour later at 8 p.m. Eastern Time USA, 9 a.m. Japan, for a smaller conversation with students. Students who are interested need to register in advance for that. And then all of you, students and non-students alike, are also welcome to join us on October 21st at 2 p.m. Eastern Time USA for an Evangelical Catholic Dialogue on the New START Treaty.Thank you all for joining us this evening.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Everything. Everywhere.